Welcome, good morning. I am Mattia Madio. I am part of CMCC Risk Assessment and Adaptation Strategy Division. And today I will introduce you to a new CMCC webinar titled Urban Flood Modeling in a Changing Climate by Roberta Padulano, working for the CMCC Division Regional Models and Geohydrological Impacts. A brief introduction to CMCC, the Euro-Mediterranean Center on Climate Change, is a non-profit research organization born in 2005 and focused on research about climate change and its interaction with the environment, the society, business, and policymakers, with the objective to stimulate sustainable growth, protect the environment, and develop both mitigation and adaptation strategies. The center has seven offices spread around Italy, working together with public and private entities in multidisciplinary studies. The scientific activities carried out by CMCC are distributed among nine research divisions, which share different knowledge and skills in the wide field of climate science and cover a variety of topics, including climate simulations, hydrogeology, impact modeling, climate services, economics, mitigation and adaptation, agriculture and forestry, and ecosystem services. Now, the outreach of these activities come in the form of scientific publications on international journals, events and communication activities for the public at large, and the targeted educational program. So please use the GoToWebinar panel to write down your question. We'll dedicate 20 minutes after the presentation to ask. And the next CMCC webinar, in advance, it will be tomorrow on water risk again. The title is Drought and Floods, Complex Interaction in a Rapidly Changing World by Giuliano Di Baldassarre. And now, please, I will give the word to Roberta, and she will introduce her presentation. Please, Roberta, go on.
Thank you, Mattia. Thank you, Mattia, for your introduction. And thank to you all attending this webinar. My name is Roberta Padulano. I'm an hydraulic engineer and I work for the CMCC Foundation and in particular for the Regional Models and Geohydrological Impacts Division. In this presentation, I will show you some insights about the complex and challenging topic of urban flood modeling under the conditions of climate change. The introduction of climate change information within the modeling of physical processes has become, in last years, of course, a pivotal research topic. And this is especially true for urban areas, for urban context, because on one end, because of the extremely high exposure of urban areas due to the increasing population and to the presence of strategic buildings and infrastructures. And on the other hand, because it was demonstrated that the negative effects of climate change are exacerbated in urban context by the typical urban geometries and features. Negative effects such as an intense warming, poor air quality, and extreme weather and climate-related events such as storms, floods, and heat waves. In this context, the REMI division is implementing a strategic project named UrbanPro, Integrated Assessment for Urban Protection, which has three main goals. First, understanding and modeling the effects of climate change on the temperature and rainfall regime of urban areas. Second, modeling the impacts of those effects in urban context. And finally, third, advancing knowledge concerning planning, design and management of adaptation measures. Of course, the implementation of these goals implies dealing with some complexities and challenges that can be grouped in two main issues. On one end, the difficulties in obtaining reliable and representative projections of the atmospheric variables of interest, such as rainfall and temperature. And this is especially true for the related extremes. And on the other hand, the implementation of effective and reliable impact models. As is suggested by the title of this presentation, we will focus on rainfall-related events, and especially about urban floods. Now, the modeling of urban flooding involves the modelization of a number of physical processes that can be grouped in two consecutive steps. First, there is the need of modeling the extreme rainfall regime of local areas, and second, there is the need of modeling the transformation of this rainfall into runoff. To go a little bit in detail about this, we can say that the rainfall runoff transformation can be seen as the combination of two consecutive steps. First, the hydrological part, namely the water balance, to understand how the rainfall volumes partitions into the three main components of runoff, infiltration, and evapotranspiration. And second, the hydraulic part, to understand how the runoff routes into different physical existing systems, such as the artificial drainage network, namely the sewer system, a river network or water bodies located inside the areas of interest, and the uncontrolled surface runoff. In urban context, we can typically neglect the evapotranspiration component because of the different timescales involved. And we are also going to neglect the component of river network or water bodies that can be present inside the urban area. Now, the rest of the presentation is structured in two following this division. So, first, the part concerning the modelization of the extreme rainfall regime of local areas, and then the rainfall runoff transformation. And I will show you some strategies and approaches that the REMI division proposes to solve to deal with these two issues. Now, let's start with the first part, so the modeling of extreme rainfall. The REMI division has proposed a methodology that is aimed at modeling the future expected extreme rainfall regime of local areas. In other words, it's able to estimate the rainfall depth for any given rainfall duration and return period by means of a model that is valid in the future for the future rainfall regime of local areas. In other words, the future updated intensity duration frequency curves. Now, this methodology, we can say it relies on three main pillars. First, the approach establishes a parallel with the current official intensity duration frequency curves. According to this methodology, the rainfall depth for any given rainfall duration and return period can be computed as a product of two parameters, namely the first, the mean rainfall only depending on rainfall duration, and the second, the growth factor only depending on the return period. So the proposed methodology is aimed at quantifying the effect of climate change on both these parameters separately. To do this, the methodology relies on the daily rainfall annual maxima extracted from 19 climate models included in the Eurocortex project. And to quantify the effect of climate change, it relies on objective statistic criteria and hypothesis tests. The methodology was tested and applied on a local area represented by the Rain Gauge Napoli Servizio Idrografico, where 30 years of observations of rainfall depths and annual maximum rainfall depths for different durations were available. As a result, the future expected rainfall depth or intensity for an assigned rainfall duration and return period can be computed as the product of a rainfall value for the same duration and return period estimated for the current period by means, for example, of the current intensity duration frequency curves or by observations, multiplied by a change factor, that is a function of the return period, that can be easily estimated by simple regression equations fitted on the local area of interest. And of course, it also depends on the specific concentration scenario and future time horizon chosen. This figure represents the relation between rainfall duration and rainfall depth. The blue curve represents this relation for estimated by means of the current intensity duration frequency curves. This figure refers to a specific return period, namely 10 years. And we can see, for example, that for a duration of 12 hours, the current rainfall depth is about 90 millimeters. Instead, the red curve represents the ensemble mean, namely the average of the results of the application of the methodology for all the 19 different Eurocortex models, along with a variation band by means of a standard deviation. And this curve represents the extreme rainfall regime expected in the future. And so it provides, for the same rainfall duration of 12 hours, a higher rainfall depth, namely in this case 120 millimeters. So this means that in the future, according to the methodology and for the area of interest, we are going to expect for the same return period and the same duration a higher, so a more critical rainfall event. On the other hand, this means that a given rainfall depth for an assigned rainfall duration is going to be expected in the future with a lower return period, namely a higher frequency. So this suggests an increase in the criticalities of the extreme rainfall regime for the area of interest, because it suggests that it is in the future we have to expect even more intense rainfall events that will occur more often, so with a higher frequency. Of course, this method has some limitations. For example, the method does not take into account the errors and biases of each climate model. However, it does take into account only the intermodal uncertainty, namely the variability of results among the 19 Eurocortex models, by providing an ensemble mean and the standard deviation. Moreover, there is a strong assumption, because the methodology was applied for the daily rainfall depths and the results were extrapolated for sub-daily durations. However, this uncertainty was preferred to the uncertainty deriving from using sub-daily results of climate simulations that are known to be poorly reliable. Finally, the model does not comply at all with sub-hourly durations. However, this is also a limit of current intensity duration frequency curves that are not valid for sub-hourly durations. And this is due to the general lack of sub-hourly observations. Now that we have an instrument, a tool to model the extreme rainfall regime of local areas for both current and future period, we can pass to the second part, namely the modeling of the rainfall runoff transformation. As I mentioned before, the rainfall runoff transformation can be seen as the succession of two steps, the hydrological part and the hydraulic part. Both components depend on a large number of parameters and variables, such as space and time resolutions and scales, antecedent conditions, the characteristics of the rainfall event, and so on. This means that there is not just one model able to model and solve all these physical processes, but there is a large number of available models in the literature that focus on one process or another with different degrees of detail and complexity. In my opinion, the choice of a particular model should be driven by the specific purpose of the analysis, that could range from risk analysis to the design and verification of drainage networks. This is because the particular goal we want to achieve requires some outputs to come out from the model, such as information about inundated areas, about flow velocities, about discharges flowing within the sewer system. And in turn, these particular outputs require some input for the model, for example, the characteristics of the rainfall event or the characteristics of the surface or the sewer system. Now, the remedy vision within the context of the strategic project is particularly interested in modeling the urban flood hazard and to quantify and understand the possible influence of climate change on pluvial flood hazard. So, within the large number of available models in literature, we decided to use a particular model, that is the Kadiska flood model. This model was implemented by the team of the University of Exeter that I would like to thank for their support, both technical and scientific support in the last months. We decided to use this model because, in our opinion, it represents a good compromise between output reliability and variety, the amount and the level of detail of the input needed and computational effort. The typical input required by Kediska flood is a digital elevation model. This is the grid on which the computations are based. Information about surface roughness and infiltration rates, and information about the rainfall event. The last three parameters can be given as unique values for the whole map or as a specially distributed information. And infiltration rates and rainfall values can be given as constant or as a time series. The outputs of the model concern both water depth and flow velocity. One value for each grid cell, as a specially distributed information, and one value for each instant of the analysis, so also as a time series. So in practical terms, the outputs of the model consist of one map of water depth and one map of flow velocity for each instant of the analysis. Of course, as all models, even these models has some limitations, but also opportunities. For example, the sewer system is not explicitly taken into account by the model, but it can be accounted for example, in a simplified way by means of artificially reducing rainfall volumes or increasing infiltration rates. In the same simplified way, adaptation measures could be modeled, such as low impact development systems, for example, pervious pavements or additional green areas, by an artificial reduction of rainfall volumes or increase infiltration rates only in the areas where the adaptation measure is going to be placed, in order to simulate the additional water obstruction caused by the adaptation measure. Moreover, the fact that the model is able to output also velocity information as well as water depth information makes this model particularly prone to be used for hazard mapping purposes, because hazard maps should take into account both the information. Finally, there is the big problem, the big issue of calibration and validation, which is not only a problem of is an issue, we can say, of this model, but of all the inundation models, namely models giving information about inundated areas. This is because to verify these models, observations of inundated areas should be needed, and this is a data that is rarely available. However, this kind of models can still be of support in planning, design, and management, for example, of drainage systems, by means, for example, of simple comparative evaluations. This will be clearer in the next slides. The case study I would like to show you concerns a small area in the eastern part of the city of Naples, where an important strategic building, namely a hospital, is located, and this area was affected in the past by significant flooding problems, so it is quite an interesting case study. For this area, a LiDAR-based digital terrain model with a resolution of 1 meter is available. The total extent of the simulated area is 150 hectares. Moreover, information about land use, land cover is available. The land use map suggests the presence of 13 different entries, most of them related to green areas. About half of the map is related to green areas, followed by surface related to roads and streets and buildings. For the sake of simplicity for computations, these 13 entries were aggregated in 4 different surface types that can be considered homogeneous in terms of infiltration rates and surface roughness. We have surface type A that gathers the surfaces related to roads and streets. Surface type B, namely man-made surfaces, this means impervious and artificial surfaces that do not experience intense vehicular traffic. Surface type C related to green areas, and surface type D related to buildings. There is a positive infiltration rate even for artificial surfaces to account for the presence of artificial drains and gutters. This physical system, this case study, was tested by means of the CADI scaffold model in order to understand the effect of 3 parameters that we were interested in, namely the return period, the rainfall shape, and the infiltration rate. So 2 parameters related to the rainfall and 1 parameter related to the surface. So let's start with the first. Why are we interested in the effect of the return period? This is because this effect gives information about the resilience of the area of interest with respect to modifications in the rainfall intensity values. In fact, we are interested in understanding if a modification in the intensity values used as input for the model translate in a small, an equal, or a larger modification in the output of the model, for example, runoff volumes or inundated areas. If a big modification, a huge modification in the intensity, in the rainfall intensity, provides only a slight modification in the flooding characteristics, we can say that the area is quite resilient to modifications in intensity, and so it will be resilient to climate change, since we showed that that climate change alters, modifies the intensity values. In turn, if a slight modification in the intensity values provides a very significant change in the outputs of the model, this means that the area is not resilient at all, because even the slight modification, the slight increase in the intensity values used as input will provide an exacerbation of urban flooding problems. The effect of the return period was investigated by assuming as input of the model a rainfall event with a duration of 1 hour and 5 different constant intensity values, corresponding by means of the current intensity duration frequency curves to 5 different return periods ranging from 2 to 10 years. For each event, the model outputs that we are interested in are the time series of runoff volume and of flooded areas. We can see that both the volume and the flooded area increase in time with rainfall, reach a maximum at the end of the rainfall, where the rainfall volume has reached its maximum, and then decrease. Another important output of the model is the inundation map, so the water depth map and the velocity map, one map for each instant of the simulation. This is the picture of what happens at the instant, at the time where there is the maximum value of runoff volume. For example, we can see that for water depth, the highest values are reached within a couple of underpasses located in the area of interest, whereas the maximum velocity values are reached along the main streets and roads. If we compare what happens in terms of time series among the different return periods, we can see that for each instant of the analysis, both the runoff volume and the flooded area increase with increasing return periods, and so with increasing intensity. However, the most important information we can notice by looking at the relation between the increase in intensity and the increase in the maximum runoff volume, because we can see from this picture that the relation is perfectly linear, but with a slope that suggests that the volume increases more rapidly than the intensity. For example, when the intensity roughly doubles, less than doubles, the maximum volume roughly quadruplicates. So this means that even for small changes in the intensity, we have larger changes in the outputs of the model. This implies that the area of interest is not very resilient to modification in intensities, and so it will be not resilient even to climate change. The second parameter we are interested in is the rainfall shape. This was investigated by assuming as an input of the model for a rainfall event with a duration of 1 hour, but with a discretization of 10 minutes. And the rainfall intensity values corresponding to these subdurations were derived by the current intensity duration frequency curves under the assumption that they are still valid for sub-hourly durations. This was in fact confirmed by the 10 minutes observations related to a rain gauge that was placed nearby. So each of the 6 intensity values were computed by means of intensity duration frequency curves, assuming a return period of 5 years. but were organized in a different way. However, all the four events share the same total runoff volume. If we compare the results in terms of time series of runoff volume and flooded areas, we can see that the peak values of runoff volumes and flooded areas are the same for the four events, so this value is not sensitive to the particular shape of the rainfall event. However, what is different is the path to reach the maximum and, above all, the timing between the critical instant where the maximum runoff volume is reached and the instant where the flooded area, the maximum flooded area is reached. In fact, for the rainfall events where the maximum intensity, the peak intensity, is reached near the end of the event, we have quite a timing between these two maximum conditions. Whereas for the rainfall shapes where the peak intensity is reached at the beginning of the event, we have a maximum flooded area that is reached, that is very anticipated with respect to the condition of maximum runoff volume. This will be more clear if we look at just one of these events. This is the inundated map, so the water depth map corresponding to the time of the simulation where there is the maximum runoff volume. As we can see from the picture and from the graph, this corresponds to a flooded area that is not very high. It is between one third and one half of the map. In fact, we can see that about half of the map is uncovered by water, is dry. Instead, if we look at what happens when we place at the instant where the flooded area is maximum, this is the situation. So about the entire map is covered by water, but with the water depths that are so small that the total runoff volume is quite small. If we compare this condition with a condition where the rainfall intensity is constant during the event and is such that the total runoff rainfall volume is the same, we can see that there is no significant change with respect to runoff volume, and in particular the peak runoff volume is the same, although the path to reach the maximum is different, but there is a significant change in terms of flooded areas. In particular, if we assume that the intensity is constant during the event, we are going to underestimate the maximum flooded area. Finally, let's concentrate on the last parameter, the infiltration rate. We were particularly interested in this parameter because modifying the infiltration rate, we can, for example, simulate the presence of adaptation measures. In this case, we wanted to simulate the presence of the positioning of pervious pavements by substituting all the surface type B, man-made surfaces, with the pervious pavements. And so this was simulated by increasing the infiltration rate of surface type B from 15 to 50 millimeters per hour. This value was assumed by means of a literature analysis. So this in this picture, this is what happens for the baseline, namely when the surface type B has infiltration rates equal to 15 millimeters per hour. So this is the very same inundation map I showed you a couple of slides ago. Whereas if we increase the infiltration rate of man-made surfaces to 50, this is what happens. I'm going back and forth to show you the difference. So basically what happens is that there is no change at all in terms of flooded area, it's quite the same. And there is just a small increase in runoff volumes, and in particular the maximum runoff volume is a little smaller, is a little decreased, and is reached a little earlier than the baseline. So in this case, the pervious pavements affect in a very poor way the urban flood conditions of this area. This could be due to the fact that the total extent of these surfaces is quite small, is about the 7% of the entire map. So it could be not sufficient to reduce, to effectively reduce runoff volumes. So this is my last slide. I would like to summarize some general lessons learned by looking at these case studies. As I mentioned a couple of times within this presentation, there is a large number of existing urban flood models, and so the choice should be driven by the specific purpose of our analysis, because this drives the outputs that we need, and the outputs in turn require specific input for the model with a certain variety and level of detail, keeping in mind that the higher is the number of physical processes we want to simulate, the higher will be the number of input data required and the quality and the level of complexity, and the higher will be the computational effort required by the model. We saw that the urban flood process is influenced by a large number of variables and parameters, some related to rainfall, some related to surface. And these parameters affect in a different way and by a different amount different characteristics of urban flooding. For example, some parameters could affect rainfall volumes, runoff volumes, some others could affect inundated areas. For example, we saw that the rainfall shape does not particularly affect rainfall volumes, that proved to be more sensitive to the total rainfall volume, but in turn rainfall shape particularly affects the inundated areas, and in particular the timing between the maximum inundated areas and the maximum runoff volumes. In fact, the maximum values of inundated areas proved to be located where there is the maximum value of rainfall intensity. Finally, I would like to stress out that the map of inundated areas is not alone sufficient, is not enough to understand the process of urban flooding, because it should always be considered in combination with information about volumes, about water depths, to discriminate between severe flood conditions and simply wet surfaces. Okay, this was my last slide. I would like to thank you for having attended this webinar. I wish you merry, merry holidays, and I'm looking forward to hearing your question. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Roberta. I have a couple of questions about your excellent presentations. So could you give us a bit more details on how the assumption for rainfall distribution are used? So what is the source input and the size of the source input, and how it is downscaled to the local level?
Okay, I'm going to the related slide. Okay, so you mean about these rainfall events?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, how the events are modeled, what is the form of the input, it is a high resolution grid, or how it works?
Okay, the information about rainfall, we decided to consider and pointed information, namely we used to obtain these values of rainfall intensity, we decided to use the intensity duration frequency curves for the area of interest. What I mean is that the intensity duration frequency curves for the city of Naples depend or are organized as a couple of equations that are that can be fitted with respect to the elevation of the area of interest. So we basically entered with the average elevation of the area of interest, and with a fixed return period, we decided to use 5 years, and a fixed duration, and we decided to use 1 hour, we could simply derive from this couple of equations the values of rainfall intensity. Of course, the duration we entered was not 1 hour, because this is the total duration, but 10 minutes, because we wanted to I mean, 10 minutes, 20 minutes, 30 minutes, up until 60 minutes, that is 1 hour. In this way, we maximized the intensity for each time step of 10 minutes. And then once you obtained those different six values, we decided to organize them in four significant ways. For example, we decided to use a decreasing shape and an increasing shape. And then we came up with two different nested values, with just keeping in mind that we needed two events that were somehow realistic and that were characterized by a peak intensity that was placed in two very different positions. So one near the beginning and one near the end of the event. So what I mean is that the basis for this computation were the intensity duration frequency curves for the city of Naples that are perfectly available in literature.
Thank you, Roberta. And how would be possible to relate the scenarios, the return periods elaborated for the local area to the future RCP scenarios, so scenarios in 2050, 2080. Would it be possible with this approach?
In our opinion, it is possible. In this case, I would like to show you to focus on this slide. Keeping in mind that in the horizontal axis, the increase in intensity can be also seen as an increase in return period. So this is the same. Because if climate change, as we showed in the first part of the presentation, gives an increase in rainfall intensity, we could, for example, enter in this graph, in this picture, with an assumed increase in intensity given by climate change, and so estimated separately, and understand by looking at this picture how and what amount the runoff volume will increase. So this graph is quite a bottom-up approach. I mean that it is valid in general, but if we enter, if we look at this graph entering with climate change information, we can use it in a climate change perspective.
Thank you, Roberta. I will encourage our public to ask questions. So we have 10 more minutes to ask this to Roberta. I have another one while we collect more. So did you account for the translation of the hazard intensity measure into economic risk, or will be a part of your work to include also an estimate of risk, considering that you gather almost all the data that are required to do that?
Yeah, this would be the last step. This is a very interesting question. We are very much interested in this kind of analysis. However, we at the moment we have stopped to this phase. To be true, there is another step between these points, these issues. So for example, I talked about hazard mapping purposes, I did not show anything about this. For example, with this approach, we will be able to obtain hazard maps that are not either inundation maps or velocity maps, but are maps that combine this information to account for the fact that, for example, a high water depth could not be dangerous if the water is still does not move, but if the water depth is high and also the corresponding velocity is high, this could be more dangerous. Once we have obtained the hazard map, then we could pass to the risk information, combining this information with information about exposure and vulnerability, and then ask ourselves what are the economic consequences of this kind of hazard. This will be the last step, and it is, of course, our final goal.
Thank you, Roberta. I have a question from Karl Schulz. So I'm most interested in characterizing the delta between baseline flooding outcomes and those over different times with climate change. Could you further clarify how you explain and understand the uncertainties in this difference? It will have tremendous impacts on planning and climate events attribution along with finance. I'm not sure if I got it.
This, I think, quite a complex question because it involves maybe some points that we have already touched, although in a, not in detail. So, as I said, of course, this approach could be used to understand the effect of climate change. This is what basically we are interested in, so understanding the influence of climate change on urban flood hazard and hazard maps. For example, if we quantify the effect of climate change as, for example, an increase in the rainfall intensity or a modification that makes a rainfall event change into another, for example, with a different distribution, a different shape, and different intensities, we could quantify by means of this model the difference between a baseline, so a current situation, and a condition where the rainfall input accounts for climate change. And the differences lie in a large number of parameters, so there is not just one answer to this question. For example, we could be focused on asking ourselves what are the differences in terms of runoff volumes, because this is a water volume that we are going to we will need to discharge somehow, for example, with the drainage system. We could be interested in understanding what is the effect on inundated areas, because we could find out that in the future areas that were safe from flood, instead they are safe no more. We could be interested in flow velocities if there is an effect of climate change on flood velocities, on water velocities. So the starting point will be, of course, the quantification of the effect of climate change on the extreme rainfall regime. And once we have understood this, then the propagation of such a change along the model will allow us to understand what happens, what changes in terms of different flood characteristics. So we need to first assess what we are interested in. As I mentioned a couple of times, we need first to understand what is our purpose, the final purpose of our analysis, and then we can decide how to proceed.
Thank you, Roberta. So I don't have any more questions from the public. So it's your last chance.
Okay.
If there is no more question, I will thank Roberta, and I will remind you that this webinar has been recorded, so it will be made available to CMCC channel, so websites and YouTube. So thank you for participating. We have another. We have a thank you from Carl Schultz. And so we'll see you next in the next episode, and thank you and good lunch, everybody.
Thank you and goodbye.